Welcome into this week's Degrees of Science. We're getting closer and closer to the big April 8th total solar eclipse, and we're going to talk in a little more detail about it with our resident eclipse expert. We got Dr. Barbara Endl from Baylor University. So gearing up, getting closer to it. For folks that may not know, what's some of the kind of the nuts and bolts that kind of go together to cause a total solar eclipse?
Well, thank you very much for having me again here. It's a pleasure. So the moon orbits around our planet Earth, and the Earth and the moon orbit around the sun. If those orbits were perfectly aligned, we would see eclipses every month. It is an amazing coincidence that the angular size of the moon is exactly the same as the angular size of the sun, as viewed from our planet. In other planets, that's completely different because the ratio between the sizes and the distances is completely different. But we are in a very special location. So if these orbits were perfectly aligned, we would see eclipses every month. Every new moon, we would see a total solar eclipse. Every full moon, we would see a total lunar eclipse. But there is a 5-degree inclination angle that makes eclipses so special for us.
We had an eclipse back in October, but it was an annular eclipse. How can we have different style eclipses with it's the same moon moving in front of the sun?
That's an excellent question. So when Kepler tried to fit the data from the planetary orbits, he actually realized that the orbits are not circles. They are actually ellipses. And this is true for every single object around the sun and for most of the moons around the planets. They are nearly circular orbits, but they are not circles. They're just a little elongated ellipses. So in the particular eclipse that we had in October, the moon was just a little bit further away. So when the moon passed in front of the sun, it didn't fully cover the disk of the sun, causing the annular eclipse.
Okay. And I guess that's where we get the term supermoon as well, when it's a little bit closer in its orbit.
Exactly, so we have a full moon and it's a little bit closer to us. That's what we call a supermoon.
I'm learning all this astronomy stuff as we get closer to it. So, on the day of the eclipse, as the sun's gradually, or the moon's moving in front of the sun, what kind of changes will people see going on as that starts to occur?
So it's gonna get darker, it's gonna get colder. I think that's the biggest changes that we're gonna observe. Bring a jacket if you're gonna be outside. I know it's April, everybody is already feeling warm and the spring coming in, but yes, it will get colder. It's surprising how much the amount of sunlight will be diminished.
Wow, that's amazing to be that much cooler. So for someone that, say, lives in an area where it's partial compared to in totality, how much of a difference is the view from those two locations?
Well, it's literally night and day. So whenever we have the totality, it will get dark. It will get dark. We will be able to see not only the most amazing things, which are the corona of the sun and the diamond ring and the 360 degrees sunset, but we're also gonna be able to see stars, planets. So it gets a little weird kind of shade of blue, but it's a very beautiful, unique kind of blue. It's very similar to what we saw during the annular eclipse. You see that it's getting a little darker, but it's not quite sunset, you know what I mean? So we all have seen that already.
So you were talking about the changes, and I remember during the annular eclipse where I was, it wasn't a total where it went completely, but I noticed even my dogs acted weird, like they could tell something. When you get into totality, I know it gets colder, it gets darker. Do animals and everything act a little different during that?
Yes, we're gonna hear cicadas flying and the trees and all of that. When I saw the total solar eclipse in 2017, I noticed babies were crying as well, which is like crazy. They think it's nighttime. So it's not only the puppies. And I actually recommend as a fun experiment to take your puppies outside and see how they are reacting towards the whole thing. Nature will get confused.
That's amazing. Yeah, to see. So when you were talking about when it goes into totality, there's a few things that we'll see in that kind of last few seconds there. What exactly is the diamond ring effect?
So it's just when the moon is about to cover fully the sun and you see still shining, and that's beautiful. It's really, really cool. But then when the moon is fully covering the sun, the disk of the sun, then you can see the corona, which is part of the ejector of the sun. It's just beautiful. To me, I think it's one of, it is the most beautiful natural phenomena that I have ever seen in my life.
And you know of, personally know of people, I mean, people are going to travel likely around the world to come along this path to be able to see it, right?
Absolutely, yes. People, we don't cross the street to go from 98% to 99%, but we travel around the globe to see a total solar eclipse.
So it's a long time till we'll ever get a chance. Even really in Texas, I mean, in our lifetime, there'll never be another one that moves through here. So kind of shows how historic this is, right?
Yeah, so we say that eclipses are not rare per se. They happen every other year, basically. A year and a half is on average. But they are very rare where they happen. So that's what it makes this so special for us here in Waco.
A lot of people have talked about, you know, you just need to disconnect during it, and because trying to take pictures and video, it's your phone's not going to give it justice of what you're going to be taking in during that 4 minutes of totality, right?
Yes, I cannot take good pictures, so I can only take pictures of my kids. I think that's pretty much it. But unless you have a very good camera and the proper filter, because it's not enough for you to put this films here in front of a magnifying camera. If you do have that, please make sure to buy the proper filters for your camera, depending on the magnification that you have. Same for telescopes as well. But yeah, I waited for the professional pictures to come out. They were much better than what my phone could do.
And speaking of on your glasses, so you've got some new ones and old ones. So this was from the last eclipse, right?
Yes, this is from 2017. And do not use something that looks like this. This has been sitting on my junk drawer in my kitchen. This is not okay anymore, the especially because the filter portion here is bent. Okay, so this is just a memory thing that I carry around. But yes, if you have the one that you used already, this is totally okay, as we can see here. It does have this ISO number, 12312-2. That's the actual number that will tell you that the transmissivity of this filter is 0.0001%. Okay. It's tiny. It looks completely black. If you are going to purchase something right now, I also recommend this kind of films here. This, just because these glasses, I mean, people have different sizes in their heads, and the children also don't see it very well. But with this one here, you can even put in front of your glasses, and that's actually pretty comfortable. I would say. For the little kids, there are several websites, and I should have prepared one better here, but you can cut out a paper plate around here and attach the glasses to a paper plate, especially if you're talking about children like 3, 4, 5 years old, because the sides are not very protected. So this is something, and again, remember, put them on, look at the sun, look away,
and and when it goes from even 99 to 100, once it gets to 100% totality, you don't have to have the sunglasses.
Yes, you take them off. Yes absolutely.
Because you'll miss everything pretty much then, right?
Yeah. And there's no substitute for this. Okay, I heard of people saying, oh, I can put on 10 sunglasses. No, please don't do that. The damage of the sun is permanent in your eyes, and there is no way to recover from
that. Is there a limit of how long you should look through these at the sun, or is it pretty much safe if you want to do
it? It is safe, yes. Okay. If you have the proper ones, it's okay.
That 4 minutes when that eclipse is going on, how much would you recommend everybody that humanly can get outside to be outside during to see that?
Yes, I was happy to see lots of districts have canceled classes for the day. This is perfect because the kids will have the opportunity to fully experience that with their families. It is a misconception to say that something bad is going to happen during the eclipse. It's not dangerous. It's not harmful for you. There's nothing, no changes in the amount of radiation that comes from the sun or any, I mean, it comes less, obviously. But it is not different than a normal sunset. So nobody should be scared. It's a beautiful, amazing natural phenomena. You should all be super excited about it. Go outside, bring your kids outside, talk to your neighbors.
Coolest things during the annual eclipse I saw is where like the light coming like through trees and how it spread the shadow and looked like a whole bunch of eclipses. So it's really, there's a lot of cool stuff you can really take in during an eclipse.
Yeah, the pinhole experiment, it's very fun to do. I recommend you, the kids, they can actually get a cardboard and punch pinholes with their names, for example. We're gonna have some at Baylor with a BU, of course.
Nice. It's cool, those little things, and like I said, this is a great avenue to get kids and people interested in a science field that they may not know a bunch about. And you've got a bunch of cool stuff here. So let's start with these little beads here. So that if people can see, these are little, nearly clear, like beads you'd make a bracelet out of, but they are a special type of bead, is that right?
Yeah, so those are UV beads. And what you can teach the kids is the sun emits in all wavelengths. Pretty much, but the sun is yellow mostly because the bulk of radiation is in yellow. But it also emits in ultraviolet, that's why we have to put on sunscreen, otherwise we get sunburned. It also emits in infrared, you know, much less than in yellow, that's why we see it. But if you take those beads that are transparent now here outside, and they will change their colors.
Wow.
And there are several cool experiments that we can do. For example, I'm gonna shine here because I don't have the sunlight, a UV lamp, and you can see here that they actually change color. And I put inside this this container for medicine here. I put some more beads here. And I'm gonna do the same thing, shine the same light, but I'm gonna shine from the outside here. And I'm shining for the same amount of time, basically. And if I remove them, they did not change colors. I don't know if you can see here. Yeah. So this is an experiment that you can do with the solar beads, the UV beads. You can make bracelets and teach the kids that even in a cloudy day, you can get sunburned because there's still ultraviolet radiation passing.
So the bottle's just blocking the ultraviolet rays is why it's not getting to that, yeah.
Yeah, for medicine, this is important because we don't want to change the chemistry of the components.
Okay.
You can also make this rubbing them. This becomes a little messy, but with sunblock. You can do sunblock. I actually did for the teacher's workshop that we had in January. We had expired sunblock. And then again, they change color.
Well, Dr. Endl, I've already roped you into multiple of these interviews, so I appreciate you taking time to talk with us, sharing your excitement and knowledge about this.
Well, thank you so much for having me. And yes, go outside, enjoy the eclipse, and don't forget your glasses.
Yes. Awesome.